Hello, everyone. Good afternoon, and welcome to today's edition of Issue Sync. It's Nevis. 1:42 is our time. I'm EK checking in with you. We'll be here until just about 3 o'clock this afternoon. Issues will be two-pronged today. I've got some specially invited guests in studio already. And then immediately following their departure, we'll open our telephone lines and, of course, get into conversations about issues of the day. Your questions, comments, concerns, and queries about anything that, you know, you think is worthy of your attention that you can share with your fellow nationals both home and abroad. Of course, we give thanks to our partners for making it possible for us to be here each and every day to share with you. In the month of December, don't forget, middle of the month, we normally close off our issues program. But, of course, you know, we can always come back in if something happens or is going down and we need to have national discourse. So, just be mindful of that. Those of you already viewing on the Facebook page, shout outs to you. Hope you're having a great day today. It's hot on the outside, so if you will, please remember to remain hydrated, preferably island purified water. Or if you live countryside, you're done there. You could just turn on your pipe and bang with that. Yes, I. All right, so my first conversation will be with some folks from the Department of Environment already in studio. So let's say hi and hello and get into that conversation. Ladies, good afternoon. Welcome to Freedom FM. If it's your first time, don't worry about it. Everybody's welcome here, just as if you're home. Don't worry about the viewers. They love everybody who comes here. All right. So good afternoon. Welcome.
Good afternoon.
Okay. All right. Around the table. Introductions, please. Treat me as though I don't know a thing what's going on here this afternoon.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Carrie Doerr. I'm the National Coordinator of the Invasive Alien Species Initiative, part of the Ministry of Environment. And that's what we're here to talk to you about today. So I'll give you some more details about that shortly.
All right. Welcome, Doc.
You said you don't know me.
I could pretend.
Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Clark, Joyelle Clark. Today, I am the communications coordinator for the Invasive Alien Species Project with the Department of Environment
Great. Yes. So we're here to talk about that specifically. So there's a whole program lined up, a project lined up to inform people about what's going on with that. So take me through that as if I don't know at all what's going on.
Okay.
Sure. I'm going to do a brief overview of what's happening here in St. Kitts and Nevis, and then my colleague from the Center for Agriculture and Bioscience International, Naitram Ramnanan, is here to give us more of a regional update. Mm-hmm. But in terms of the general project, in case persons aren't aware, the Caribbean is a biodiversity hotspot. So we have in the region over 11,000 plant species, over 70 of which are only found in this region. So that means they're endemic. We use the word endemic for species that are only found in those places. And research has shown that worldwide, invasive species are one of the biggest threats to biodiversity, but on islands specifically, they are the number one threat. So as a result, the Global Environment Facility, the GEF, which a lot of persons know about, they have a lot of small grants around in the country, the GEF and the UN Environment Program has currently an initiative supporting invasive species research in the region. The project is called Preventing Costs of Invasive Alien Species in Barbados and OECS Countries. There are three core countries at St. Kitts and Nevis, Barbados and Antigua and Barbuda, and then there's four additional non-core countries that are only participating in some regional initiatives, and that's St. Vincent, Grenada, Dominica, and St. Lucia. So the word alien always makes people laugh or kind of confuses people, so I wanted to speak about that specifically. We use that word to make clear that we're focusing on species that have been brought from elsewhere. Because local or native plants can become invasive, usually as a result of human habitat modification. So that sort of extra term in there is used to show us that we're focused specifically on plants and animals that have come from other parts of the world to this region. To call something invasive, most persons understand that, but generally speaking, it means that it's expanding. That species is expanding to the detriment of the ecology. So that could be other species or water, mm-hmm. human health, or other aspects of our economy like agriculture. Okay. The folks from CABI and UNEP, they did some early scoping work coming to these countries and talking to persons about what species were problematic to them, what did they think was the most important issue for this specific country. And in St. Kitts and Nevis, it was clear that the species deemed most problematic was the green monkey. Technically, it's not the vervet monkey anymore. It's kind of been given its own species name, but people also know it as the vervet monkey. So nationally, for our federation, over the last 3 years, we've been focusing on documenting the green monkey's impact to agriculture, biodiversity, tourism, and households. Tourism has been a bit challenging, as we all know, with COVID. There haven't been as much tourists coming in. But with the four ships yesterday, I'm thinking we might be able to get a little more info about the way the monkeys actually impact persons' decisions to come to St. Kitts and Nevis. You know, are they valuable as we generally think they are valuable to the tourism industry? So we've got a lot of data that we've collected over the last 3 years, and our goal, the key deliverable for the pilot project work we're doing, is a sustainable and scientifically informed monkey management strategy. So we will be creating a management strategy that we'll be sharing with the government in hopes of really helping offset the major issues that we found on the country with regard to the green monkeys. And then in addition to that work, we have a major goal of just sort of educating the general public about invasive alien species. We want to get folks on board with preventing their entry. That's a big issue. That's the number one thing you can do, is just keep them from coming at all. But then for the invasive alien species that are already here, we want people to know what they can do to manage those species and prevent their spread. So we're starting now our communication, education, and public awareness campaign led by Dr. Clark. And this month we're highlighting two major invasive plants here, the coral creeper that everybody knows as bee bush, the pink flower that you see everywhere, okay. as well as wild tamarind, bread and cheese. Mm-hmm. So my colleague...
Those are invasive?
Yeah.
But since I little buy them things here.
So that's the thing. Green monkey's been here since you born, too.
Oh, my God.
But they cause problems and... They're pushing out native species. I think that's the biggest thing. They do have some value, but the key thing is that when they're here, they are just so prolific that they're pushing out the plants that are really special to the region. We want to protect that.
But what are some of the key factors that cause them to be invasive, though, given the definition that you gave about invasive?
There are some real key biological components to invasive species, but the biggest ones are that they reproduce really quickly and really effectively, regardless of, you know, some of them are going to just be carried by wind, some of them by other animals. There's some other components too, but that's a big one, that they can live in a lot of different environments, that they're highly adaptable. They don't need one specific type of environment. Like the monkeys that we have are one of the most wide-ranging monkey in the world, so they can live in, you know, semi-desert, tropical rainforest. They can eat all kind of things. So that makes them especially hard to control.
Wow. That is some good information. Mm-hmm. But in terms of them, like, reproducing and flourishing, do they do that in their environment that they were actually originated in? That's the same way they behave? Okay.
Yes. So that's how they've become successful in their... the areas where they're endemic or native. But as often the case, when you've evolved in a place, there are systems to keep you in check, like predators, for example, or diseases that keep you, you know, for plants, there are going to be certain diseases or insect pests that might keep your population growth under control. So when you go to a new environment, it's like none of that's there to keep you in check. So
So nature has a way of balancing out itself. Yeah. All right, I get that. So in terms of educating people as to how they can keep these things in check, what does that look like, though?
Well, first we wanted to speak to Bob, right, and talk specifically about those two plants. And then I'd like to get more into what we're doing regionally in terms of communication, nationally in terms of communication, and then we can get into all those questions, too. But I wanted to
bring in Bob
while Bob is here, yeah.
All right, Bob, good day. Are you there?
Yes, good evening. I'm here. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Right.
New experience of me being on the radio in St. Kitts and Nevis.
Welcome, man. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
All right. So, yes, the good doc says you have some information to share with us before we get to any deeper conversation about the whole project. So go right ahead.
Okay, so I think Carrie covered it very well. Just to add, it's a regional project, as she pointed out, and there are three core components to the project. Component one deals with policies and legislation and action plans and so on. Invasive species is not a new problem. As Carrie's pointing out, the monkey came 300 or 400 years ago. So it's always been a serious issue in globally. And the at a global level, we are fighting it at a global level where you have agencies such as CABI and other international organizations looking at it. The UN Environment Program, the Global Environmental Facility, et cetera. And then you have it being tackled at the regional level. So you have CABI has done quite a bit of work to demonstrate to the region that, you know, it is quite a serious issue, both in terms of agriculture, in terms of biodiversity, and even in the marine and freshwater systems. So it is serious. I see it primarily to some extent as an economic problem because people bring species in for economic reasons more than anything else. And the two species that are being highlighted by the project, or before I get into those, let me cover the other two components. The second component, and Carrie alluded to that, is managing some key species. And in the case of St. Kitts and Nevis, it's the green monkey. In Barbados, it's lionfish, controlling rats and mongoose that are affecting the hawksbill turtle. And in Antigua, it's rats in the Osho Island. So component two is really developing strategies and control programs to actually control or eradicate invasive species. And then component three is a regional component. And this is where we have to tackle it at a regional level as well. So it's being tackled at a global level in terms of information and capacity building and so on. And then also the regional level. And at the regional level, we are developing tools. So for example, in early next year, we'll be launching an IAS app for the Caribbean. We've already launched the Caribbean Biosecurity Interception System, CBIS, and that helps to record all the interceptions and give us data to improve our surveillance work. As Kerry was pointing out, it is extremely important to prevent entry. And because our resources are so scarce in the region, we need to develop tools and techniques to better utilize that resource. So for example, what that would do is it would tell us if there are lapses within countries in terms of passenger or cargo. If we find, for example, coming in from Mexico or Jamaica, for example, more species that are potentially invasive, that means that the controls, I'm just using those as examples, and that doesn't mean to say that that is the case. So that we need to put tighter controls in that case. Also, we are at the regional level developing capacity in terms of training people to do risk assessments and so on. And we've built capacity to look at the economic impact because very often when we speak to politicians about these issues, they want to know what is the economic importance of it. And therefore, we need to generate that kind of data within the country itself to speak better to ministers of finance, for example, and policymakers. So that's a little bit in terms of what we hope to achieve. So we have like the website and those kinds of things at the regional level. To specifically come back to the two species that I think of as of concern or being promoted in St. Kitts and Nevis for this month, the coral creeper, Antigonon leptopus, and wild tamarind, as it's called in St. Kitts and Nevis, or Leucaena, leucocephala. Incidentally, both of them, according to the CABI Invasive Species Compendium, originate out of Mexico. And why should we be concerned about, and I think you were pointing out that you thought it was native because you've lived with it and, all your life. It is important that we control some of these and at least try to stem their spread. Both species, for example, the coral creeper is year-round. It flowers and seeds year-round, and it could build up quite a bit of dry matter under the vines if it's running on the ground. It could smother trees. So it is displacing your native trees, and it is changing your habitat to some extent. So for example, sugarcane was grown in large areas in St. Kitts and Nevis, and now it's being taken over, and the sugarcane itself would have displaced some of your natural vegetation. And now that the sugarcane has more or less been abandoned, you have the wild tamarind taking over. That in itself is being facilitated to some extent. People think of climate change, but in my opinion, it also contributes to climate change. So for example, if you have large areas of the coral creeper, that lends itself to increased bushfires and that sort of thing. That releases carbon in the atmosphere that is a vicious cycle of contributing to greenhouse gases and climate change and global warming and that sort of thing. So these invasive plants, both of them do things similar to that. So for example, the wild tamarind, that can be over time, a very large tree. And I'm sure you would have noticed where they exist, then you tend to see only wild tamarind. That is important because let's take, for example, we don't have much studies in terms of the impact in the region, but let's take, for example, our honeybees. They are being threatened worldwide. And for example, research in Europe has shown that the diet of the honeybee, because of these invasive plants dominating the landscape and the honeybees having to feed only on limited plants, their diet is affected in the sense, just like how humans need to get their proteins and their nutrients from a wide range of sources to be healthy, the honeybees also need to forage on different types of flowers. So if they're foraging only on just a few species, the health of the honeybees, which are very important in terms of pollinating not only agricultural crops, but your native plants. And then if the bees are affected and the pollination is less, you know, so you can see the vicious cycle of how invasive species affect your ecosystem, your habitat, you know, your wildlife in general. I don't know if I've given you too much. So for example, if you have to reclaim or put back your abandoned sugarcane lands that have been taken over by the wild tamarind, the cost of just land clearing is just going to be phenomenal. So the economic impact, and that's why I said to some extent, if we don't have the data to demonstrate the impact on biodiversity and on the environment, we certainly have the data to demonstrate that this is of severe economic importance. I don't know if you've ever tried to get rid of the coral creeper or the bee bush, as you call it, in St. Kitts and Nevis. Mm-hmm. It comes back up because it has a tuber underground. So if you cut it or if you spray it with a herbicide, it comes right back up. The birds spread the seed. The seeds can be dispersed by water as well. So these are, as Kerry mentioned, some of the key features of invasive species that tend to be able to reproduce in almost any kinds of environment and take over. So I think I'm going to pause there to see if you have any other questions or if I've answered your concerns.
Well, to be honest with you, sir, you have just put a couple of things into perspective for me, because as I told the good doctors who were here before, growing up, these are things that I saw. So I really thought that they belonged here. But now when I look back down Sandy Point High on top of the hill there behind the hospital, all the vegetation that was up there is basically gone because of this same coral creeper. It basically
took over
and just destroyed all the trees.
Mm-hmm. And if you look at the aquifer, for example, now, that's a wild tamarind forest.
Right.
It's just covered in it. Yep.
So everything that was there is now God,
Rastafari. Yeah. So some people refer to it as green deserts. Example for it's probably not important in St. Kitts and Nevis, but certainly in Trinidad and some of the other islands, Dominica, for example. Bamboo, when we see bamboo at the side of a river, we think it's beautiful and it's very natural and very inviting
exotic.
And picturesque and all of that. But the bamboo supports very little wildlife in terms of animal feeding on it, or it doesn't flower much, that sort of thing. But it is displacing, it is changing the habitat. So for example, around riverbeds is where you, what we will call a riverine type ecosystem or habitat. Mm. And you have certain birds and fish and so on that is adapted to that kind of environment or habitat ecosystem, whatever you want to call it. And the bamboo changes that. So for example, they work in Florida and Jamaica and other places, certain types of birds that require, like for example, grasses to make their nest and to feed and that sort of thing. They thrive in that kind of environment. When the thing like the wild tamarind takes over or the bamboo takes over, those native species that are adapted to your environment then gets displaced. And then what we have happening is biodiversity is a rich mixture of living species, both plants and animals. And when you have fewer and fewer species, less and less biodiverse and ecosystems, it becomes less resilient. So a large fire or a hurricane or whatever, for the environment to recover, what you have happening is that the invasive species tend to take over, and with time, those environments become less productive.
Wow, this is mind-blowing. I'm trying to like go back in time and visualize some of the things that, in terms of plants and animals, that I don't see anymore.
Right.
And this is the reason. I was just thinking that because, you know, we get old, we don't observe.
They're going.
Oh, wow.
Because of the invasive species.
So all this information that you guys have collected, don't they inform, like, you know, policy and legislation in terms of how people move, what they can move with, and how effective has that been for you guys so far?
Right. So I guess that's where I come in terms of the communication, education, and public awareness program. How effective are they? So we want... That's why we're here at Freedom, to ensure that the listeners for Freedom get this information and come on board with the Department of Environment to say, yes, this is a problem. Mm-hmm. We need to build the public awareness so people understand that when you come to St. Kitts and you intentionally smuggle something, you can create a problem, which for us in 20 years, because 20 years since we've left Sandy Point Primary High School, and we left there knowing that we would go on the cliffside and play and everything was there. Now we go back, all we see is coral creeper.
Right.
We think it's nothing of it, except now Bob has explained to us the problem in displacing vegetation that really needs to be there.
Wow.
Spoke with a farmer and he said, he was showing me a piece of land and he said, I've given up on this land. And I said, why? And this was a couple of years ago. He said, that bee bush, once that bush takes root, that's it for your farm. And we take it for granted, but now we're seeing, based on the information presented by Bob, that it's problematic, not just for food security, biodiversity, pollinators, etc. So we have planned a full communication rollout, which includes coming back here to Freedom FM every month for the next 8 months. An educational tour where we're going to the high schools and also potentially partner with CFBC to ensure that there is more information, especially through the STEM program at the Education Ministry of Education level, about these invasive species. And of course, we want to engage the public more with our social media ambassadors. We want to ensure that there is some, whenever people think of IAS, I know people think, the other day somebody said, IAS? You mean you're doing something with Island Auto Supply? So immediately we recognize that, hey, we probably need to,
I hope they're listening.
So people could understand that invasive alien species are problematic. Even the very ships that come here with things that we need, the ballast water from the ship could be problematic. When we come back later on, when we're dealing with lionfish, we're going to see, even from the Department of Marine Resources, the experience that people are having with the vegetation that can come through that same ballast water when they offload and unload.
Tourism is invasive species too?
No, everybody. It's a multi-stakeholder approach here that we need. Everybody needs to be involved.
If I can interject.
Yes,
sure,
please.
Come on.
I think two countries in the world that have really taken invasive species very seriously is Australia and New Zealand.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Primarily because 40-something percent of their GDP comes from agriculture. And agriculture is probably one of the sectors that are most affected by invasive species.
Mm-hmm.
Their approach is that it takes a country to deal with a problem like invasive species. In contrast, many people in the Caribbean see it as a public sector or a public good, or the government should be dealing with it. And I think to add to what Joel is saying, we really want to encourage the average man on the street to be a champion in terms of the invasive alien species issue. And they can be a champion by simply not to bring it in, hiding a little piece of plant,
mm-hmm.
or some sort of fish or any frogs or spiders or whatever when they visit some other country, bringing it, think they can sell it in the pet trade or whatever, without first getting approval from the Ministry of Agriculture, Department of the Environment, whoever it is. That is key. So, mm-hmm. you know, people need to change their behavior in that respect. If you have a pet, you should not let it go in the environment. Take it back to your pet shop, humanely euthanize it, things like that. So we need everybody to understand the importance of it and to be a champion and be aware of how your unintentional actions can have a big impact on the environment. Hmm. And that impact may not be immediate.
Right.
That could then be 50 years, 100 years down the road. But that impact could be speeded up with things like climate change.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Okay.
So there are a number of stakeholders who are on board with us already. As Bob rightly said, it's not just a public sector approach, not just governmental.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we're here on the radio today. Like, so for example, in the construction industry, in tourism in particular, you bring container loads of goods or even vegetation for landscaping if you're mm-hmm. constructing a hotel. And we've heard of stories in St. Kitts and in Nevis where a container, you open it and you're expecting only to see palm trees, and out comes a snake or an iguana or something that's just eventually problematic.
I've seen some kind of spiders where I never seen in my life.
Right.
Did you see the food? They just had a big old iguana come out of a food container
right.
in the last month.
Mm-hmm.
And the snakes in Nevis. I never
yes.
know. Just last year.
Right.
So all this is due to
all of this invasive alien species.
Well, yeah, it's just that we have so much. It's a globalized world that we live in now. So just
right.
the way that information, but also physical things are traveling from place
mm-hmm.
to place.
Mm-hmm.
You got to have a lot of checks and balances.
A lot. So we want especially to partner. We're partnering with the customs, in particular, Air and Seaport Authority,
mm-hmm.
with the persons who are involved in landscaping, who bring in a lot of the flowers that we go and buy, especially right now at Christmas, we're going to buy stuff. We want to decorate. So these are key partners. And community groups, because they do a lot of the underground community awareness environmental campaign. So we want that included. We want everybody to partner, and of course with the students.
Mm-hmm.
And importantly, the social media push, because, you know, in St. Kitts, we are quickly becoming a social
media.
Then if it doesn't happen on social media, it doesn't happen.
Nobody
and that's
knows.
Why it's important that we're going to push from January. The social media ambassadors are champions to ensure that this message takes over. I think it's important for me to say also, as I close, that we have each month, we'll be back with Freedom with you, and we will be speaking to key species. So this month, we are speaking to coral creeper and the wild tamarind. Then we're going to be dealing with rats, mongoose, the tropical bunt tick, and mealybug. Everybody remembers when mealybug first came to St. Kitts, yeah, and it was a big problem.
Mash so we're going to citrus,
really,
Selassie, you know,
fire ants.
Yep.
Monkeys and lionfish. And I don't want to end without mentioning donkeys in Nevis. So we don't have this yet as one of our top invasive species, but we will be reviewing the list in terms of ensuring that people recognize that even donkeys are becoming a problem. Mm-hmm. Well, you go to Nevis all the time. And what is the one thing you see on the road?
We have dogs down here kicking dung pans and so, donkeys in Nevis.
Right.
Accidents, eating your vegetation, your little garden in the back. So, right. Yeah, it is a problem.
Car accidents, right. Because they're always along the road.
Always along the road. Definitely. Another key partner would be Ross University, but I'll allow Kerry to speak about that. But I want to mention the communication team that's working along with the Department of Environment, Chameleon Media. So they're going to be pushing a lot of the social media that you're going to see. So we're going to be everywhere. That's our intention, because we need to protect our biodiversity. So listeners, you could go to the Department of Environment social media pages. So Facebook, it's at Environment SKN. The Instagram page is at DOESKN, and of course YouTube is Department of Environment St. Kitts, and the website environment.gov.kn. So for today, we want the first person, especially those persons who can go to our Facebook page, to post the scientific names of the coral creeper and wild tamarind. There's something in store for you.
There's also CaribbeanInvasives.org, which is going to give you some more of the regional context to what's happening here. Okay.
So we want to boost the social media following on this page. So the first person to go there and post something special will be in store for you, the scientific names, and Bob gave them to us. Yep. And they've been all over, so post that. And I think if we get callers today, I hope we get callers today, tell us some of the very interesting uses of wild tamarind or bee bush, because they have medicinal uses, but too much of one thing good for nothing, and this is the case for the invasive species.
We're also
curious
about issues persons might be having with these species as well that maybe aren't on our radar yet.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, boy. Well, tell us more about the Ross side of things as to how we deal with these things and what you guys are doing.
Well, Ross, as such really the only U.S. accredited veterinary school in the U.S. is just a wealth of resources and information and experts. And so we're engaging with them in a few ways. On the one hand, we're trying to highlight a lot of the work that they're doing on species that we have that are invasive. So right now there's a team doing a lot of work on lionfish, encouraging persons how to hunt and eat them, the way that they can be prepared. So they're putting together some nice audio visual stuff about lionfish that we'll be promoting as well. We want to talk about the research that they're doing. We want to share any publications that they've put out. Same for mongoose and green monkeys. I think those are the three main ones. Also the bont tick, right, because of its impact on livestock in the country. So any work that's being done by Ross, we're going to be highlighting to just let people know that it's happening here and inform them on the results. With regard to the monkey, they have done a lot of stuff really more from the medical side. But then for this specific project, the Invasive Alien Species Initiative, I'm coordinating three different research projects with teams at Ross looking at virus, parasite, and bacteria transmission between people and monkeys. Because, we never used to see monkeys in the villages, and since the sugar industry closed, we're really finally having a lot of physical contact between monkeys and people. Like, even if it's just in your backyard, they go and sit on your picnic table and then you go and sit and eat out there. Is that affecting our health at all? Mm-hmm. So that in the new year is going to be a huge initiative. We're going to be trapping and sampling 100 monkeys. Five of the traps are in really busy human areas, and then we've created a trap way up in the mountain to sample monkeys that really don't come into contact with persons, so that we can look and see, are we seeing higher viral loads, parasite loads, bacteria loads, antibiotic resistance with monkeys that are coming into more contact with people. So, in the next year, we should have data to help us understand if being around monkeys is actually negatively impacting our health as well. So exciting stuff coming up.
I would be interesting to find that out, definitely.
Yes.
All right. So we have a caller already. We got a couple of moments left. So let's hear what this caller has to say. Caller, you're on. Go ahead.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Jesse. Good afternoon to you.
Mm-hmm. Good afternoon.
Panelists on the program. I just listening to you all and I'm saying, wow. Mm-hmm. When I was a much younger girl coming up, I could have gone in Nevis especially. I could have gone on the side road and pick an apple, mm-hmm. pick some kind of food.
Right.
And we can't do that now. Because the monkey, they're fussing you. The mongoose them, they're fussing you. So everything like it just going out of season. You know, you gotta buy everything. And then the tamarind is a very good medicine for your body. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the tamarind give you, okay, you could get a girl pregnant and get a clear baby, but it's your own.
What's the...
But just that you don't clear.
Judgment.
Once she drink a lot of tamarind, that baby gonna come out so clear and nice.
Oh my God!
Well, you might make that as a yawn, but the
you baby gonna come out nice. What's
so tamarind drink?
Doctor, hello? Confirm this.
Oh no, I can't. I'm not a medical doctor.
So Ike,
you make me dear boy.
Yeah, so I'm telling you the truth. So tamarind is a very good, but. You know, so much tamarind tree in Nevis, no one, nobody's studying it. Nobody's studying them.
Tamarind or wild tamarind?
Wild tamarind.
Okay.
And tamarind. You know, so that's all I have to, that's my little input.
All right.
Okay. Monkey them mashing us up, man. Mashing us up bad.
Thank you so much for that. All right. So I guess in light of all this information that we know getting, I think the question would be on everybody's mind is how do we control these things? How do we prevent it? How do we get rid of them if there's a get rid of? Because I know that some people don't really like that word of getting rid of anything, so I get that part. But in terms of control, so I'm curious to know what will be the plaster for all of this, so to speak.
Well, it's going to have to be country and species specific. So in different parts of the world and with different species, you're gonna have different approaches. So we didn't really come prepared with specific strategies for today, but as we go through and we have more data specific from St. Kitts and Nevis, and we have, like Bob was talking about, the regional app, for example. So that sort of thing, it's basically, we wanna first of all respect quarantine rules. That's a prevention strategy, and that's really number one. And then for some of these other species, we're really in a lot of a data gathering period right now, and we want to do more citizen science. That's, you know, all the people here can be scientists. They can help us, once we get this app out, identify priority areas for management, right? Because same with the monkeys, right? Right now it's just shooting willy-nilly, and that's really not going to be effective. It's the same with all these other species. So where's bee bush having the biggest issue? Where are the biggest negative impacts? And then when we have more of this data, then we can have really targeted strategies specific to those plants or those animals. So again, it's not something we can speak of specifically, but we really want to make people aware of what species are a problem here from the data that we have. And then as we gather more information, we can help come up with specific plans for each of those species.
Good sound. All right, we'll take about two or three more calls and then we can wrap it up for this segment. Call you around, go ahead.
Yes. I'd like to find out what you call a coral creeper. Is it a bee bush with the pink flowers?
Yes, that's what it is.
Oh, but they have another one as well. And the root is the same thing. It's very deep and hard to pull up. Right? But their leaves are finer. And at one time I was watching something with a lady. She had cancer and she reached as far as Mexico to find that bush, and I keep wondering if that bush, because she wanted the root of it to make the cancer treatment for her.
Okay.
Right? So I keep wondering if that one that is in my garden is the bush that she was looking for. Because that's another creeper again. You pull it up, if the root was off, it just spring back up. But I know for the one with the bee bush, that one, when I had the flu last year, that was one of the ingredients in the bushes that they boiled for me for tea with ginger and garlic and so on. That helped me a lot. And I know, like when we used to go to school down by the pox in the hospital, it was on the fence. And on Friday time, we used to dress up with all the flowers from it to play bride. So that was one thing we used to do with it. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you so much.
Can I just make a quick comment?
Sure, Bob. Come in.
Yeah. I think we must not dismiss the local knowledge like that. Mm-hmm. But I can say for a fact that if, in fact, it had any cancer-fighting properties, it probably won't be spreading all over like that. It's been proven, for example, that soursop has those kind of anti-cancer properties, and the demand for soursop is quite high. Mm-hmm. Science has been, a lot of our medication come from the wild, and science has been looking at all the properties of these wild plants. And if it had that kind of property, it probably would have been known by now. I'm not dismissing it, but if that is true, I think that would be a good thing, because then there will be a high demand for the plant, and then that demand by itself would help control it. But I think we need to, the point I'm trying to make also is sometimes these unproven claims, people see the need to move with it, and it could be a cause for the spread of invasives. So for example, the giant African snail first was spread by people thinking that they could farm it for sale to restaurants, specialty restaurants, and so on. So that's the point I'm trying to make. I'm not dismissing the link with cancer. I'm trying to make the point that we need to have a scientific background to these claims before we try spreading them or encouraging people to go down that route. That's the point. I hope I'm not confusing the issue.
All right. Well, good input. Balance. Caller, you're on. Go ahead.
Brother Ike.
Yes, sir. You're on.
Good afternoon, sir.
Blessed day.
Brother Ike, what about the jumbie bead? You know what we call the jumbie bead?
Yeah, them that we used to put in oil lamp and so?
Yeah. They say that is good for many ailments, you know. And you have the stinking weed. Remember we call it stinking weed?
What is it? Is that
stinking weed, and people used to make coffee from it. And when children, newly born children, had what do you call it? Upset stomach.
Colic.
They used to use the root of that tree.
Okay.
To put in them in the breast milk and give the child. And that would cure the child. And as I said before, people used to make coffee from the seeds of that plant. And that was one of the best tasting coffees. And then you had the castor leaf. Mm. The castor leaf bush, which was good I don't remember the cure. But then you had the French sticky thyme, which was used for painful menstruation. And once upon a time, all the guts in St. Kitts were filled with fruit trees. People never used to be hungry. Other things were hard. People could have gone up to into the gut and filled the belly with grapes or mangoes or apples. But nowadays, the monkeys have destroyed those gut fruits. And so people are now suffering from hunger, you know. But and then, you know, once upon a time, they used to dig sluices. You remember those sluices in the villages and in the cane fields when rain fell to collect water?
Yeah.
And that is where we were always fortified with water supply. But nowadays you have concrete instead of the sluices, and so no water is collected. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you so much for that call. We'll take one more and then wrap it up and allow the ladies to carry on with their day and their important work. Caller, you're on. Go ahead.
Yes, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
He's all right with everything he said. The sluice, I also think, Michael, that it was for catch the water, catchment for the water for the cane field. This is what I understand, but he said for more water. Well, I first time heard that. Yeah, I learned about the sousap root. You know, we always drink the bush, and someone told me that at one time the root good for the cancer and so. And there's a lot of bush. You know, right now I just find out a bush the other day, you know, good for pain. Right, she was speaking about the wild tamarind a while ago. Yeah, always growing, that dear good. You have this short one, the bitter one, good too for that too. And the bush, coffee bush, what Mr. Ting just talked about, that good too for the pain and so on, and like kids, for big people too. You know what that good for, Ike? If you get a pound finger, right? A prick, not really a pound, a prick in your finger, and then you don't want to go to the hospital for that, so you bear with it. And like 2 nights after, you heat that bush, the coffee bush, and you put it on with a little Epsom salts and some Vaseline. It pull it out. At one time, I saw that happen to me in St. Martin. And in St. Martin, when I was there at one time, the same bush he's speaking about, the castor seed bush, Mr. I get a pain in my back. And somebody told me about it, so he heat it and then go and put on some kind of heating thing. You know that time Benga used to store that? We used to go with Benga from thinking, even though in St. Martin and so on. That time we never know much about white rub on them. Right. And you put it on, and you know that heel you eat, eh? I saw a lot down there the other day where my barber, and I saw them cut it down. That's what they cut them down for. There's good thing, they know what they're good for. Okay.
All right, then. Thank you so much. Well, given the calls and all the stories, I'm hoping that most of you would get the app and, of course, upload the information, your location. The app can accept pictures and that kind of thing, too, so we can identify
it. It will.
Okay,
not
good.
Not ready yet.
All right, so we can look out for that, and I'll be sure to encourage everybody to get that, and so we could help the good doctors with their project and, you know, help us eventually on so many levels. So around the table, your final comments. Bob, you want to go first?
Well, thank you for having me. I think, and thanks to the callers, I think the comment from the caller with respect to the fruit trees in the wild and the guts or whatever you, in St. Kitts and Nevis, imagine if people are hungry, what is happening to the wild animals?
Mm-hmm.
We really need to protect the environment and ensure that invasive species is not disturbing the environment in the long term, and encourage everybody to do their part.
Mm.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us. Doc?
Yes, thank you everybody for listening, and thank you to the callers for coming in with their questions and comments, and just keep an eye out for all of our stuff. Please do pay attention to our social media pages, and call in next month when we're here again.
All right. Thank you so much for coming. Doc, right. Your final words.
I think I'll just say see you next month. Come back to talk about another invasive species.
All right.
So thank you for having us.
If I invite you, come to it. Don't
forget. Okay. Thank
you. The more the merrier. All right. Thank you so much, ladies. Have yourself a great day, and looking forward to sharing with you some more, and of course working with you.
Yes.
All right, it's 2:30. We're going to take a short break, get a word from the partners, and come right back with the second half of Issues. Stay with us.
This December for the holidays, the Music Man at 21st Street in St. Martin brings you a new line of iPhones. iPhone 13, 13 Pro, 13 Pro Max, all available at the Music Man. A perfect gift for someone you love. Get your favorite PlayStation 5 with new games. Call of Duty Vanguard, FIFA 22, NBA 2K22, all available at the Music Man. Not only this, we have